Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this ICON post of endothelitis measures to regain confidence. We'll be dealing with the whole gamut from the etiology, microbiology to the long-term complications and the legal aspects. As we know, endothelitis is the inflammation of the inner cords of the eyeball, leading to suppuration in the vitreous cavity as a result of inoculation by microorganisms. And this leads to a very variable visual outcome. We don't know what the visual outcome will be. Although the incidence has declined over the years as a result of better diagnosis and antimicrobial therapy, but still the visual outcome is a big question mark. So as we know, post-op endophthalmitis is most common after a cataract surgery, simply because that's the most common surgery we are doing. And these are some of the preoperative risk factors like untreated meibomitis or dacryocystitis or conjunctivitis, contaminated eye drops, operative risk factors, wound abnormalities, a wound leak probably, a vitreous loss, a vitreous wick which might be getting in the microorganisms, prolonged combined surgeries, and contaminated irrigating solutions. To help us in better management of these cases, it is important that we understand the enemy first, and the enemy here is the pathogen, which we can find out by the presentation. Whether it's acute, delayed, or chronic, we can have an idea about the pathogen involved. Plus, of course, there is the direct evidence of the pathogen through the vitreous aspirate or through the aqueous humor. But then that, as we know, is a big hurrah moment if we get a positive culture report. As we can see that, it was the in the EVA study, the culture positive rate was 69.3%. And in one study, it has been put at 52.6% in India. So basically, we are relying on what the literature tells us and what to suspect in our cases of post-op endophthalmitis. It's interesting to understand what the normal flora is, because it is from here only that the microbes are gaining entry into the ocular surface. So in one study, 49.4% of the isolate was P. acnes, 24.7% coagulase negative staph, and 4.3% staph aureus. There's another study which said that the inner canthal region was the most contaminated, and coagulase negative staph, that is the staph epidermis, was the main component of the conjunctival flora. This is another study on the difference in the conjunctival anaerobic and aerobic bacterial flora in pediatric versus adult subjects. And this basically said that P. acnes was more common in adults than in children, and streptococci was a more common organism in the conjunctival cul-de-sac in the children as compared to in the adults. So coming to the most common cause of post-op endophthalmitis, the post-cataract surgery scenario. According to one study, the incidence of post-cataract surgery endophthalmitis is 0.09%. According to a meta-analysis by Taban et al., the overall incidence of post-op endophthalmitis was 0.128% from 1962 to 2003. And thereafter, the incidence of endophthalmitis post-op increased as a result of development of the temporal or the clear caudal incision as compared to the scleral incisions which were being given before. And according to this study from University of Utah, again, this incidence of post-cataract surgery endophthalmitis decreased from late 2003 to 2007 when the fourth generation fluoroquinolones came into vogue. The EVA studies, what does the EVA study tell us, which forms the backbone of how we treat post-op endophthalmitis? In this study, 94.2% was culture-positive endophthalmitis cases involving the gram-positive bacteria. 70% of the isolates were gram-positive coagulase negative staph, 9.9% were staph aureus, 9% were streptococcus, 2.2% enterococcus, and no anaerobes were found in this study. And in contrast, a survey from India, the literature from India says that gram-positive bacteria, in contrast to the EVA study, accounted for only 53% of the post-op endophthalmitis cases, 26% were gram-negative isolates, and a lot of fungus cases were also found, 17%. And the important part is that evidence suggests that the incidence of MRSA ocular infections is rising, both in total numbers and as a percentage of all staph aureus infections. Now, this is a matter of concern for us in India. Another series coming from India, Nocardia was the most common organism found in post-op cataract endophthalmitis. And in another one, it was a Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which was not only the most frequent gram-negative bacilli causing post-op endophthalmitis, but was the overall most common pathogen. This is a slightly different study from the western part of the country with gram-positive organism predominating, And amongst the gram-negative organism, it was not the Pseudomonas as said previously, but it was the E. coli, which was the more common gram-negative organism. So this is just to sum it up. This is a chart which I have taken from the CME series of AIOS on post-surgical endophthalmitis. In cases which were designated as fulminant, that is those which were seen within 4 days of the surgery, gram-negative bacteria and streptococci were the more common organisms. And these two have got worse visual prognosis, the gram-negative and the streptococci. And in the acute cases, that those which appeared between 5 to 7 days, it was staphylococcus dermatitis and other coagulase negative cocci, which was more common. In chronic cases, that is more than 4 weeks, the delayed onset ones were due to P. acnes and fungi, and delayed entry I'll deal with later in the bleb-related cases. So again, as I said, the major cause of concern over the years has been the increased incidence of MRSA. And these MRSA, that is the methicillin-resistant staph aureus, are not just resistant to methicillin, but also to the fourth-generation fluoroquinolones. So it's not just after cataract surgery that we're getting endophthalmitis, but after different other intraocular surgeries also. Now this is a study from IGO, which said that after cataract, they had incidence of 0.053% and 0.5% after PK and 0.018% following other type of intraocular surgeries with the equal proportion of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. In this paper, they also found a lot of polymicrobial infection and an equal proportion of gram-positive and gram-negative. So what does the text say? In Ryan, the post-operative endophthalmitis has been put at 0.04 to 4%, post-cataract surgery is 0.265%, post-PK 0.382%, post-vitrectomy 0.05%. In the Indian study, post-anti-VEGF is almost 8.5%. The incidence of bleb-associated infection was put at 0.2 to 9.6%. Now this is a study on post-PPV endophthalmitis from Shankar Natralia, I think. And here the most common organism was the gram-negative, followed by the gram-positive and the fungal infection. Now this is a chart showing the same. We can see that the green is the gram-negative, which was the more common cause for post-PPV endophthalmitis, followed by the gram-positive. And the red is the PCR studies that they had done for chronic endophthalmitis and chronic vitritis. And I just quote from them. They said that the risk of endophthalmitis significantly lower after MIVS compared to the conventional 20G vitrectomy. And another sentence which I quote from them is that the differential surface tension of a tamponading agent compared to balanced oil solutions helps to seal the sclerotomy wounds, minimizing hypotony and associated infections. So they found less incidence of post-op endophthalmitis after PPV in cases where tamponade had been used. On the other hand, this is another study which said that post 25G vitrectomy, the incidence was more than 20G because those were sutured incisions, and so there was less chance of hypotony and entry of extraocular fluids and organisms. I think the later papers will presentations will deal more with this. Post trabeculectomy, the incidence of post-op endophthalmitis has been put at 0.12 to 1.2%, and here the most common pathogens are the streptococci. In contrast to what we are seeing in the post-cataract surgery, the organism here is different. Streptococci in acute endophthalmitis, and both streptococci and H. influenzae in delayed endophthalmitis. In addition to H. influenzae, gram-negative organisms have also been isolated in cases of post-trabeculectomy endophthalmitis. Organisms commonly staphylococci have been associated with post-glaucoma drainage device endophthalmitis. Probably they have gained entrance to the conjunctiva, which has eroded over the tube or over the plate. Now, in a retrospective study, they said that the cumulative incidence of endophthalmitis in the first year after GDT placement was 0.4%. Another study, that is tube versus trabeculectomy study, which was a randomized trial of GDT surgery versus trab with amatomycin C, the incidence of post-op endophthalmitis was less after the tube than after the trabeculectomy. This is another study on post-op endophthalmitis after trab. And they found that TRAB with MMC had most common incidence of endophthalmitis than without MMC. This is a study on post-intravitreal anti-VEGF. We keep hearing of injections anti-VEGF being given and post-op endophthalmitis. And in these studies, they count for almost 8.5% of all cases of post-op endophthalmitis. And intraocular cultures have yielded positive results in 75% of these cases, with the majority being coagulase negative staph. This is a comparison of post-cataract versus post-anti-VEGF injection, and gram-negative was the more common organism in the post-cataract surgery as compared to post-anti-VEGF injection, where the staphylococcus was a more common organism. In a study on endothelitis after PK, the incidence was, this is a UK incidence, the incidence was 0.67%, probably due to infection from the graft. Probably the grafts were not treated properly with antimicrobial agents, and the most common reason was the infection from the graft which had been taken. Gram-positive organisms here were more common. And I just quote from another study, in 60% of post-PK surgeries, the donor buttons were considered to be the likely source of infection because of growth of phenotypically similar organisms from the donor corneal rims of the donor eyeball. This is just a sum up of the post-operative endothelitis, acute onset post-op endothelitis due to mostly coagulase negative staph, that is the staph epidermidis, followed by staph aureus and streptococcal infections and gram-negative, delayed onset due to P. acnes and coagulase negative staph and fungi, and a post-trabeculectomy due to streptococcus followed by H. influenzae staph species. To conclude, post-op endothelitis is a sight-threatening condition. It's important to identify the microorganism responsible to correctly manage the condition. Microbiological analysis of intraocular fluid and knowledge of geographic area specific microorganism helps in starting the therapy. MRSA endothelitis is increasing. Atypical bacteria and polymicrobial infections are increasingly isolated. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anita, for an extensive, detailed account of all these organisms. Very difficult to remember them all, actually. Do you have any idea what is the commonest organism isolated in your setup?
Staph epidermidis, which we are finding most commonly.
Don't you find anything like fungus or some other organism?
Yeah, in the late onset ones. In the late onset cases, we are getting a lot of fungi also.
Do you ever get those gram-negative organisms as well?
Yeah, definitely. In the fulminant cases, in the fulminant cases occurring within 4 to 5 days, we are getting a lot of gram-negative also.
But by and large, it's very difficult to get a positive culture wherever in all the, most of the organizations, wherever they have done these studies. The overall yield is very less. So about, huh? Yeah, please, go ahead. Mic. 8.5, yeah.
Yeah, 8.5. Yeah. I think it's a 0.08%.
0.03% actually, it varies, yeah, it's very less. Okay.
Out of all the cases, that was the percentage.
Okay, thank you very much, Anita. So I'll be talking about the clinical features of endophthalmitis. So the post-operative infection, it's as you asked, the approximately two-thirds of all post-op cases are endophthalmitis cases are post-operative endophthalmitis. And it is commonest after cataract surgery because that's the commonest operation that we do here. And intravitreal injections are the second most common probably. And they are given for various causes. So the incidence varies from 0.03% to 0.1% in different series. The incidence of endophthalmitis, though, has sharply declined over the past 50 years. It is still one of the most catastrophic complications of eye surgery. Symptoms and signs are blurred vision, sudden increase of pain. 25% of cases, they will start at 1 to 7 days after surgery. There will be lid edema, conjunctival chemosis, yellowish exudates in the cul-de-sac, corneal edema, infiltrate, cells, flare, hypopia in the anterior chamber. And you'll have exudates on either side of the IOL. When you try to look beyond that, you'll have cellular debris in the vitreous, if you could see them. Retinal phlebitis is the first sign of endophthalmitis. Only a red reflex or a dark reflex may be visible, obscuring all the other details in few cases. There'll be poor dilatation, media opacity makes the posterior segment assessment very, very difficult. So coming to the risk factors, the surgical risk factors are the most common for post-operative endophthalmitis. let me talk slightly in detail about the wound abnormalities. Whenever you do a surgery, the cataract surgeons, they don't want to, you know, put a suture in their wound. It is very important. If you have not made a very good incision, the wound is not very good, it's better to suture. That's point one. So whenever there is a communication between the external, exterior and internal of the eye, so there are very high chances of endophthalmitis. So better to suture if you have not created a very good wound. Second thing, when you hydrate a wound, so if it is a larger wound, if it is an SICS wound, you should not keep the glove very tight. If it is very tight, there'll be widening of the lips of the globe, the incision, and there could be iris prolapse. Even if the pupil looks round, there'll be iris prolapse from that wound and there'll be communication from the exterior, leading to possibility of endophthalmitis in such cases. So you could keep the globe very tight in a smaller incision, suppose a phaco incision. But for SICS, where you make a scleral incision, larger incision, you should better put a suture there. So there were reports of corneal incisions have threefold increased rates of endophthalmitis, though not confirmed in the newer studies. It doesn't move. And other causes of increased incidence are when you have vitreous disturbance, but whenever you try to do a vitrectomy in the anterior chamber, from the anterior loop, usually it is not very complete. There'll be some wick of the vitreous or something, you know, they'll be entangled in the wound, and there'll be communication from the exterior to the internal of the eye. These SFIULs who have extrarised haptics have a higher chance of having endophthalmitis. Use of braided sutures, contaminated solutions, IOL, donor cornea, etc. They are surgical risk factors. And these ocular examinations for bacterial blepharitis, MGD, nasolacrimal duct infection, obstruction, adnuxial infections, they should be looked before the start of this surgery, not after having an endophthalmitis. And if the patient has active infection in the body anywhere, if patient is diabetic, he is immune compromised for any reason, there should be taken utmost care to keep the OT clean, the everything, asepsis care has to be taken. So these are bacterial endophthalmitis. The clinical features usually starts in 24 to 48 hours. There'll be marked visual loss, pain, lid edema, conjunctival, as I said, conjunctival hyperemia and chemosis, increasing AC reaction, hypopia. There won't be any red glow, and there'll be rapid progression of signs. In fungal endophthalmitis, it'll be usually delayed onset, mild symptoms, minimal discomfort, fibrinopurulent AC exudates, vitreous snowball exudates, vitreous abscess, and it is most commonly due to Candida albicans, Aspergillus, Fusarium. Long time back, we from Arvind Eye Hospital, we took data from all the endophthalmitis cases, and we found what Anita was also quoting, that nocardia was very common in one of those studies. This was from Arvind Eye Hospital. Down south, people have a barefoot habit, and we found out that barefoot habit was a reason for nocardia infections. The exogenous variant involves the anterior segment. So if you take a vitreous tap, usually negative cultures will be there. P. acnes, it's an anaerobic gram-negative bacillus, normal commensals of the conjunctival sac. Equatorial white plaques is seen in the IOL, and it responds very well to steroids initially. And there'll be exacerbation of inflammation when you do a YAG or you withdraw steroids. So another entity is sterile post-op endophthalmitis, where you do not identify any organism there. Here symptoms are less intense. And these are because of intraocular drug uses, gas, etc., residual chemicals from sterilization, mechanical irritation of iris ciliary body by IOL, and excessive iris or vitreous manipulation may also lead to sterile post-op endophthalmitis. And autoimmunity to lens cortical remnants can also cause sterile endophthalmitis, but it's very difficult to identify sometimes whether this is an exudate or a lens matter. So retained lens fragments and endophthalmitis may occur concurrently. Keep in mind, so suspect infection in any post-op ocular inflammation with retained lens material. This is another case of lymphoma where we were treating this patient for endophthalmitis, but finally responded to methotrexate. And if I have time, I can tell you a small story. This is a presentation to tell you that how to regain the confidence after post-op endophthalmitis. We have a case, our friend, good friend, our next door neighbor's father-in-law came to us for surgery. We did a good surgery, and the patient was very happy initially. On the first follow-up, when he comes, our colleague sees a thread in the wound, which was not connected to the anterior chamber. So he immediately took the patient to the OT and tried to remove that thread. It was very fine, very difficult to remove. In the process, there was some aqueous leak from that wound, though the thread was also taken out, but there was aqueous leak, but it was hydrated and done, asepsis. It was done in the OT with proper asepsis. Next day, patient has severe pain, redness, and of course, endophthalmitis. So everybody was jittery. We took the patient immediately to the OT, gave intravitreal injections, and he improved in 2 days' time. The redness, inflammation, lead edema, and all the hypopene, everything went away. But his pressure, intraocular pressure, rises very high, which was not, we were not able to control with all the medications. He had severe corneal edema, so visual restoration wasn't there. So, and there was significant vitreous haze as well. The residual vitreous haze was also there. Despite medication, pressure was not coming down. We decided, okay, we'll do a vitrectomy, and if possible, we'll do a trabeculectomy at the same time. So we took the patient, we convinced ourselves and the patient at the same time, and we took this patient to the OT. We did a core vitrectomy, in fact, a full vitrectomy, and a trabeculectomy. Pressure came down, patient improved. Patient was very happy in the next follow-up. And he was very happy. His vision had improved significantly, and he was much more comfortable. But to me, when I took the intraocular pressure, it was on the higher side. So I asked him to massage the globe. Maybe that will keep the blood filtering and the pressure on the lower side. 15 days later, he comes back. That time again, not able to see anything. He had an RD. So what to do? Very difficult. Again, counsel the patient, you need another surgery. We took him to the OT. We did an RD surgery with gas because we did not want to do another surgery for removal of oil. So because of the gas, he was not able to see. After gas, the bleb failed, pressure rises again. Cornea becomes edematous. Very difficult to control again. Now with medications and everything, after the gas bubble has become smaller, pressure is coming down, but still the cornea is not very, very good, actually, one must say. And we are waiting for the cornea to clear. But ultimately, we may have to do some endothelial graft to this patient as well. So the lesson learned by this case was that early detection and timely intervention saves the eye. Yet one can have unforeseen complication, and one needs to be prepared for all those things which I told you. Visual recovery may be compromised following multiple procedures. Now my question is, to remove or not to remove the thread? Thank you.
Excellent presentation, Dr. Rajesh. I have few questions for you. You can answer from here also. One is for anterior segment surgeons, that is one tendency that it is a toxic anterior segment syndrome. Seeing the early reactions in the eye after the FACO, and there will be some vitreous left also. So how do they can be cautious about that thing? TAS and the endo.
TAS usually does not present like endo as we see. It will be corneal edema, not much of reaction and hypopene. All the symptoms are also less. That is how you differentiate. But difficult. Sometimes it is very difficult. I take all these patients as endophthalmitis until proved otherwise.
And then the most important symptoms and signs, which you should, if I tell you to summarize, which you will put in order of severity, the symptoms and the signs.
See, the symptoms usually will not be very high because everybody is using steroids post-operatively, so not very marked symptoms one would see in such cases. You will have to rely on your clinical acumen, look for the signs, all other signs, like as I said, the edema, the chemosis, the AC reaction, cells, hypopene, all those things have to be taken into account.
I think symptoms like the pain.
Usually they do not come with lot of pain.
And the decreased vision.
Yeah, decreased vision is the first
these
and the
two
foremost.
I think you can tell to the patients while they are going home that if it occurs, you come very urgently.
See, to all my staff who answer the phone calls from patients, they have been told that before patient says anything, you should ask, what is your vision?
Exactly.
And if they say the vision theek hai or problem, then everybody relaxes and gives whatever advice is necessary.
And about the signs, I think the hypopene is one of the most important sign we should not take lightly. And then about the signs, the red glow and the RAPD. these two, these three signs, I should say, it helps us to differentiate from the TAS, which usually gets confused with the end of lots of times, and there is delay in referring the patients. Yeah.
I would like to add one point, for the TAS, the patient presents immediately next day, and there is a limbus to limbus maybe involvement. It is very unusual in endophthalmitis.
One more point in
or
favor of
lid edema is the very ominous signs. If a patient comes with the lid edema, decreased vision, definitely going to have endophthalmitis kind of things. In
see, the pain is a very important symptom. Initially, pain, the intensity of pain varies according to patient, but worsening of pain is the ominous sign. If you have a worsening of pain, then you should always suspect endophthalmitis, because in TAS, this doesn't occur.
And one more thing I would like to add about TAS is, in a case of TAS, the retinochoroidal complex thickening is not noted, while in endophthalmitis, it is obviously there. So if you are confused between TAS and endophthalmitis, it is you can do a B scan and measure the RC complex. And otherwise also, it's always better to be on the safer side and be more aggressive if you think, if you are confused between TAS and endophthalmitis.
I'll not take chances in my cases. I'll treat them as endophthalmitis.
Okay, so
next speaker is Dr. Indu, who will be talking about the laboratory investigations. And Dr. Indu is from Jabalpur. She had been a very bright student, and she's practicing private practice. She's doing private practice, independent practice in Jabalpur.
I would be briefly talking about the relevant investigations in a case of endophthalmitis. So history taking is of paramount importance. Workup of a patient of endophthalmitis should be considered as an emergency, because the pathogens and the toxins rapidly destroy the ocular structures. Now, once you have made the clinical diagnosis, the next task ahead is identification of the organism. So the best samples to look for the organism are the aspirates from the vitreous and aqueous, wherein you get a 56 to 70% positivity rate from vitreous and nearly 36 to 40% positive isolates from the aqueous. The samples from both aqueous and the vitreous are to be taken. Now, how do we obtain the aqueous sample? With a 30 gauge needle, and the AC is entered in a lamellar fashion, keeping the direction oblique over the iris surface, and 0.1 to 0.2 ml of the aqueous exudate or the hypopyon withdrawn. Now, vitreous is a very important source to know the causative organism. Vitreous aspirations can be done using a 22 gauge needle introduced through the pars plana just before injecting the intravitreal antibiotics. But many a times you get a dry aspirate, because in cases of endophthalmitis, the vitreous tends to be denser and it contains membrane. So the safest method is by vitreous biopsy, which can be done either with the infusion line on, wherein you will get a diluted sample, or it could be taken without the infusion line, wherein the suction port is changed with a shorter tubing, which has a syringe at its end to facilitate manual suction. So 0.2 to 0.3 ml of vitreous is taken. Other samples that you could look for are the explanted IOLs with or without the capsular contents, the IOFBs, the sutures, the abscised iris tissue, and collection from the vitrectomy sample. Now, once you have the samples in your hand, then and there in the OR, you are required to make two slides, one for Gram and one for Jimsa stain. Care needs to be taken while preparing the slide, because if you make it too thin, then it will lead to dispersion of the microbes. If you make it too thick, then it would take a heavy stain, making the identification of the organism difficult. And if you're suspecting it to be a case of fungal endophthalmitis, then you make the slide, which will be subsequently stained by methylene blue or India ink to identify the fungus. Then one drop each is inoculated into the thioglycolate broth and the brain heart infusion broth. These two are enrichment medias, and once you have done this, the samples, the broths, are then sent to the microbiology lab, where they are kept in incubator for say 16 to 18 hours. So after the standing time of 16 to 18 hours, which we give for the multiplication and the replication of the microbes, the samples from these broths are taken. Then they are plated for aerobic bacteria, into the blood, chocolate and McConkey agar. For fungus, the Saburoth's dextrose agar, and for anaerobic bacteria, the Brucella blood agar is used. Now, what are the reasons for negative culture? The presence of fastidious organisms, by which I mean to say those organisms that have complex nutritional requirement, that is, they will grow only when a particular nutrient is added to the diet. Insufficient sampling, sterile endophthalmitis, and prior use of antibiotics are few other causes. Now, repeat cultures are required in cases wherein you have the presence of contaminants in the media, or when the clinical response is not good, and in cases of fungal endophthalmitis, it is likely to be missed early because the fungus grows late. Now, a word about the neomicrobiological detection methods. This could be either the FISH technique, the microarrays, or the LEMP assays, which are still in the process of development. Then DNA sequencing. This is a very important test which can identify the fastidious and the uncultivable microbes. But the disadvantage is that the trained laboratory personnel is required. In DNA sequencing, the arrangement of nucleotides in the DNA is studied, and it is then matched with the database that is already stored in the computer. So you need to have a powerful interpretation software. However, this test is not suitable for routine clinical use. It is only used for academic and research purposes. Then a word about the Malditoff MS test. This is very fast and accurate test. Like the case of endophthalmitis, a series of endophthalmitis in PGI Chandigarh following intravitreal injections, within a period of say 4 hours, they could identify the organism to be some pseudomonoid type of organism by the use of Malditoff MS. The disadvantage is the very high initial cost of the Malditoff equipment. Now, a word about the molecular methods, the real-time PCR and the multiplex PCR. These are very sensitive and specific tests. They detect the pathogens very quickly. It has got a high transport toleration. Then PCR is very valuable in cases of fastidious organisms like mycobacteria, bacillus, cereus, nocardia, haemophilus, etc. Now, how does it work? So every organism has some unique species-specific DNA, and by this method, we make it visible. There are three main steps involved in PCR. First is the denaturation of the DNA, wherein the double helix of the DNA is broken down. And then the primers, which are specific to the pathogens, are introduced. And once the coupling between the primer and the DNA occurs, then extension of the chain by the DNA polymerase enzyme takes place. So PCR techniques have led away into the new era by allowing rapid detection of microorganisms that were previously difficult or impossible to detect by the traditional microbiological methods. However, PCR is not without limitation. There are cases of false positivity because of its inherent sensitivity, and this is due to contamination of the sample. Then absence of clinical correlation. Because in PCR you are studying the DNA, so DNA from the dead organism present in the sample could be detected as a false positive. Then the PCR doesn't comment on the antibiotic sensitivity. The cost of testing is a major factor. The cost of reagent alone may run into tens and thousands. So while you are sending the sample to the microbiologist for PCR, you have to ask the organism to look for, because then the microbiologist will put the primer specific to the PCR. Like suppose you send it for TB PCR, the microbiologist will look for only the presence of mycobacteria. For any other organism, it will not come in because it is not tested. So to test different organisms, you need to run sample again and again, putting in the primers for different organisms. However, nowadays you have multiplex PCRs, wherein 3-4 primers of the pathogen can be introduced at the same time. Then the PCR facility might not be available at all places, and highly precise thermal cycler is needed to run this test. Now, a word about the imaging modalities. Ultrasound or B-scan is mandatory in all cases of endophthalmitis wherein you want to take any interventional diagnostic or therapeutic procedures wherein the fundal details are not visible. This gives you a valuable information about the status of the vitreous, the presence of membranes and opacity, the anatomical status of retina, the extent of inflammation, choroid detachment, IUFBs, retained foreign bodies. Now, few systemic investigations like complete hemogram, blood sugar, blood and urine culture, and culture from other sites. If the patient is having some infective foci, then cultures from those sites also need to be taken. Now, a word about the cluster infection. In all those cases, you need to discuss the details, check all the related documents to find a common responsible factor for infection, determine any breach in protocol, determine the area requiring improvement. Now, as we all know, that the most common sources of infection in cases of post-surgical endophthalmitis could be either from the instruments, the patient side, the environment, or the surgical team, so all these needs to be addressed. Now, what investigations you are required to do in cases of cluster endophthalmitis? All the cases are to be reviewed for the patient-related structures, patient-related factors like the periocular hygiene, the general condition of the patient, then identify the surgeon-related factors, the hospital-related factors. So once you have an outbreak of cluster endophthalmitis, all the surgeries need to be put to a halt. Now, what microbiological samplings should be done? All the samples of the irrigating solution, the intracameral and the extracameral salts and drugs, the viscoelastics, samples from the phaco set, the phaco machine, air filters, environmental swabbings, microscope, especially the undersurface or the objective of the microscope, the patient head ring, formalin chamber, OT table, chair, all needs to be checked. Now, to summarize, once you take the samples, then it should first be inoculated into the enrichment media and then subsequently plated on aerobic, anaerobic, and fungal plates. Then PCR and molecular diagnostic methods help in the rapid identification of organisms in chronic and atypical cases. Ultrasound is an adjuvant but not a primary modality in the diagnosis of endophthalmitis. Thank you.
I have one. Like you said that whenever you send an inoculation, you send it anaerobic, aerobic, and fungal, everything you do at the same time?
Once you withdraw the sample, then you have to send it in the enrichment medias. That is, they are the liquid medias wherein the replication of the microbes is more. So you put it in the thioglycolate broth, which is specific for the anaerobes, and one in the brain heart infusion, which is specific for the aerobes. So once you have collected it in the liquid media, then it is kept in the incubator at, say, 37 degrees centigrade for a period of 16 to 18 hours. This is to facilitate the replications of the bacteria so as to increase the yield. Because when you take the sample and directly plate on the culture plates, then you don't get the yield.
So this is very important that we have to have some method so that we can increase the yield in such cases, because the yield usually is very less. One reason that we usually face is that we are not inoculating anything in our OT. We send the sample in a syringe or something to the laboratory.
That is not to be done.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Indu. Very nice presentation. You can take your seat here. Sit here. Our next speaker is Dr. Abhijit. He is the chief consultant at Priyambada Birla Eye Hospital in Kolkata. Please, Dr. Abhijit.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Rajesh, and also thanks to the audience at this hour. They are able to get the energy to come and listen. So we'll be brief. So endophthalmitis, what are the consequences if we go, why we are worried? Because panophthalmitis, corneal infiltration, and perforation, orbital cellulitis, and thyroid bulbi are the most dreaded complications, which can result in loss of vision, loss of reputation, and also medico-legal complications. So, as Dr. Rajesh went through all these slides, I'm not going to go through it in details. And incidents and everything. So, we come here, the look for, we usually, what we do, for that is only for clinical things, I wrote, put it here. So, corneal and conjunctival edema, corneal sclerae infiltrate, antechamber cells, fibrin, hypopyon, and pupillary reaction. And we do indirect and seed lamp and moderate to poor red glow, vitreous cells, poor retinal visibility are the factors clinching the diagnosis. And then we rely heavily on ultrasound B scan. So we can see 48 hours before and after vitrectomy. And we know progressive vitritis is the hallmark of any type of endophthalmitis. And this is one of our cases. If you see, the dates are written on 6th of February, on the 10th of February, and slowly you can see that is on the 11th. So slowly vitreoretinitis is increased. So this is the endothelium is progressing. First it was thought of as a corneal ulcer which came. So intervention we go for the management, it's the intravitreal antibiotics are the mainstay, covering gram negative and gram positive organisms urgently, and we tap for the stain and culture, and also for us PCR. And but we don't wait for the culture reports definitely, and we give half dose for the aphakic and the post vitrectomized eyes. And topical antibiotics we start immediately 1 hourly, and midriatics also. And if the cornea is not involved, we give topical steroids. And if possible, if the setup is there, we try to take the stain and do KOH smear to see if it's a fungal infections or not. So systemic antibiotics are question marks. We give systemic antibiotics, but lots of people and even the EBS studies showed that not all are effective. But that time the fourth generation fluoroquinolones are not there, so which was studied in EBS study. And the correction of the wound leak, suture abscess, vitreous incarceration, eroding scleral sutures in SFIL we have to do. And this is that presentation, and 2 days post intravitreal injections, you can see with the intravitreal injections alone. And the improvement signs are pain decreases, cornea infiltrate stabilizes, AC exudates become less, red glow improves, and ultrasound shows better posterior segment and the vitreous cavity. And role of steroids are much debated, but after intravitreal antibiotics we start it, and systemic is recommended, not in fungal initially, and also in diabetics. And topical, if cornea is not involved, we give topical steroids. And intravitreal steroids, there are conflicting reports. Even some people are telling you can give even after amphotericin B injection to combat the amphotericin toxicity in case of fungal even. And some people are telling no, initially you don't give. But we usually give in bacterial. And if we suspect fungal, we withhold for the first injection. So follow up every 12 hours in cases of fulminant cases earlier. Increase to 24 hours to then 48 hours follow-up as it improves, and can try repeat intravitreal as per culture and sensitivity report if the patient don't improve. And the vitrectomy, we keep it for vision less than hand movement as per the endothelial vitrectomy study. And then also we do these cases early, like cornea involving cases not responding to intravitreal antibiotic, late post-trap surgery, fungal, P. acne, traumatic and diabetics, early post-pars plana vitrectomy help. But HM vision hand movement is the one thing which we should be very careful to assess. It should be at no closer than 2 feet, and the light source coming from the back of the patient. So not that we just move the hand in front of the patient sitting when the light is from the front, because that will show us the PL positive or not the hand movement. And the principles of surgery, so eye well not removed easily in most cases. Initially, we may put AC maintainer and anti-membrane posterior capsule to be cut, and to remove safely as much vitreous as possible and avoid base excision and vacuuming the exudates over posterior pole. So this is one of the this thing which I told it put all together summarized. It is a post-trap patient in a case of operating surgeon, and we removed that anti-chamber membrane. You can see we put an AC maintainer. It is a 25 gauge. And with the cutter, we are removing the membrane from the over the endocapsule. This is the blade basically. And this is the AC maintainer we put, because it is so bad condition inside, so we will not be able to see the infusion. So we completed the surgery with the AC maintainer, in fact. Now we are removing the vitreous. You can see here, and hardly any vision. It is, you can see it is not clear at all, because we are seeing also the same thing. And then we can see there is lots of posterior vitreous exudates over the retina, and we don't know where the retina is till now. So we go slowly, we keep the vacuum low and the cut rate very high, like 7,500. And then we reach the posterior pole, and we try to use the float needle, the extrusion cannula, to see the disc so that we'll be able to see the plane of the retina. And now we do the vacuuming. And to remove as much exudates as possible. And then we go to the equatorial vitreous, but we don't try to do any heroic things. And you can see the vision. And after 4 days of core vitrectomy, this is the situation. And this is the, after 10 days, it's improved remarkably. This is one of the better cases, I should say, that not all cases give this type of good result. And then this is another patient, if we see. This is a 65-year-old lady. We can see the corneal situation, and it is going to the pan-off, basically. So we plan to do with the keratoprosthesis vitrectomy with the keratoplasty also. And that was the USGB scan, so we removed the cornea. Our cornea consultants are also helping us very much. And you can see it's all melted, like cake-like. And then the cut the thing, and you can see the amount of pus is coming. And this is the antechamber thing. And then you have to remove the membranes also inside. And that's the situation. Now we can see some iris and the membrane, and then we took out the membrane and we removed the IUL also, because there's no use keeping the IUL inside, because anyhow we have to remove, otherwise it may go down while we do the surgery. So now we put the keratoprosthesis there and fix it with 4-0 silk, and then we put the vitrectomy ports with 25 gauge, and then we go inside, and there will be some leaking there, but not much to create problem for us. And you can see this, the inside is not so bad. After removing some vitreous, I can see that it is pre-retinal exudates is not as bad as the last one which we saw, but it is organizing, because after 2-3 intravitreal, we took up the case and we removed it. So, but if you this is the sum of the exudates that they are still in the inferior periphery, so we remove them. But we don't do any heroism here. We don't try to do the PVD induction. We don't try to take out the vitreous base and anything. And then we finish it off. And here we take out the cannula. And the sutures holding the keratoprosthesis, and we fastened the cornea as per the requirements, and we took a large graft, about 8.5 millimeter, and we put it back. And those are the things, and you can see the USGB scan next day, and this is the thing. And after 4 weeks, if you see the visual acuity, if you're counting finger, but eye was saved. The seeing the initial period, what you are seeing, the cake-like cornea, and it is at least counting finger and eye was saved. So that was a thing we can achieve. So this is one of the last thing I want to tell. This is the intravitreal drug doses. I think you know that also, for my reference, I think we should put it. So we now put the moxifloxacin and the other for gram negative piperacillin and other things. I do not want to complicate, so I put up to moxifloxacin. And you can take it from the 0.5% topical drops newly opened and take 0.05 ml of it, and you can inject. That is very good. And the varuconazole also we use, and dexamethasone, cefuroxime. Those are the common things which you use, I put it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Abhijit. We invite questions from the audience. So everybody is happy and satisfied.
I have one question, Dr. Abhijit. After giving the first dose of intravitreal, suppose the exudates and everything is cleared off, but still there is a vitreous opacity, exudates are there. Would you go for the second intravitreal or go for the vitrectomy in those cases?
No,
just
if the thing is clearing up and the vision is improving, we'll wait.
No.
Thing is that if I give an intravitreal, if it improves, then we can, if continuous improvement means we can wait up to 48 hours. If it does not improve, then after 24 hours we have to intervene. Either we go for core vitrectomy, most of the time we go, or very rarely, if the patient is very debilitated condition, cannot take the surgeries, all those, then we can repeat the intervention.
Would you comment on early core vitrectomy?
Core vitrectomy will be influenced by the hand movement assessment. That's why I put it separately. The way we are taught most of the time, not always, the hand movement measurement, if you see the efforts is exam time also, they what they write very clearly. So you will see the it will expedite lots of process into CoreVitrectomy instead of the continuing with the intervitreals. And CoreVitrectomy, another thing is you should remember the point for the retinal detachment possibility, whatever be the less one.
Agreed, but there is always an advantage giving intravitreal antibiotics before CoreVitrectomy is that
yeah.
sometimes you get these PVDs occurring before, which makes our life much easier there. And despite, if you don't do a CoreVitrectomy, patient will always be unhappy. With intravitreal injections, they will always have those floaters, which are very disturbing to these patients because the expectations are very high post-cataract surgery. So as sir asked that whether you, if those floaters persist, whether will you like to do a CoreVitrectomy subsequently or not?
That is the, if the vision improves very good, then we have to talk with the patient and take the decision case by case. For the floaters itself alone, if the vision is good, I will not recommend CoreVitrectomy.
Thank you, sir. So our next speaker is Dr. Garima. She'll be talking about long-term complications and management of endophthalmitis. She is an upcoming practitioner of Nagpur, Jabalpur alumni. Please, Dr. Garima.
Good afternoon, everyone. At the onset, I would like to thank the organizers and our chief instructor for having me here. Endophthalmitis is like a war. And in a war, we know we have a sequelae. So the prevention of endophthalmitis is much cheaper than its management. Few cases come up well, but few cases need intervention, secondary interventions, and with the best of efforts, at times we lose the war. Coming to the anterior segment complications of endophthalmitis, you can have corneal opacifications, secondary glaucoma, posterior synechia, band-shaped keratopathy, ocular hypotony, and thysis. Corneal opacity is more commonly seen if the hypopyon is extensive and chronic in nature. Bullous keratopathy, band-shaped keratopathies are seen later. Secondary glaucoma is most commonly a closed angle type because of the peripheral anterior synechia and posterior synechias. Iris atrophy and atonic pupils are other late onset manifestations. Iris atrophy may unmask radial iris vessels. Posterior capsular opacification is commonly seen. Posterior segment sequelae of endophthalmitis include macular and optic nerve related pathologies, vitreous floaters, retinal detachment, drug induced toxicities. Macular degeneration and optic atrophy can be caused due to the inflammation, because of the endotoxins released, and even because of the drugs we use. In a study conducted by Zhou et al., which showed the macular changes in post-cataract endophthalmitis cases, revealed that macular abnormalities were noted in 55% to 63% of cases, with non-tractional macular edema in 7% to 13%, epiretinal membrane in 39%, though VMT was 6%, macular thinning was noted in 10% cases. ERMs, they are contractile membranes, can lead to visual changes and metamorphopsia. Influx of inflammatory cells and mediators causes activation of the pluripotent cells, the hylocytes, Müller cells, RPE, glial cells, which migrate to the retinal surface and causes cellular production of collagen and extracellular matrix, which lead to the membrane formation. The incidence of macular pucker is noted around less than 2% in EVS study, which causes distortion of foveal architecture. It contributes to decreased vision, metamorphopsia, and diplopia. If a surgeon considers that the patient's vision and symptoms can be improved, so vitrectomy with ERM removal plus minus ILM peeling can be considered. It's seen that the removal of ILM offers complete removal of ERM and limits the reproliferation of ERM in eyes undergoing macular pucker surgeries. Like in this case of ours, removal of ERM is being done. This is a thick ERM coming up. After removal of this ERM, ILM is being peeled. ILM peeling ensures that the ERM is completely removed. Next, cystoid macular edema is a common cause of vision loss. The inflammatory cascade involves the production of multiple cytokines and growth factors, which increases the vascular permeability. Persistent macular edema can cause disruption of the neural network and lead to gliosis and atrophy, which can cause permanent vision loss. Though the mechanism of CME development is inflammatory and or mechanical in nature, we can have persistent CME in cases where we have vitreous incarceration at the cataract wound or abnormal positioning of the IOL, posterior synechias, choroidal thickening and hypotony, ERM and vitreous debris. These are the cases which have persistent CME and we have to at time take a call. Few patients respond well to steroids, different modes of steroid usage, but steroids we have to be cautious for the side effects and to be very sure that the infective component is over. Vitrectomy is considered for chronic macular edema cases, and when we are performing vitrectomy, we should thoroughly peel the premacular membranes. ILM peeling should be considered with the removal of vitromacular traction. Remove vitreous adhesions to iris, capsule, IOL, and cyclitic membranes if seen. Talking about retinal toxicity, toxicity due to aminoglycosides, it's notable with gentamicin, though it is less with amikacin and tobramycin. It causes macular infarction. Amphotericin B is also known to cause retinal toxicity. As Dr. Abhijit was mentioning, that steroid is added along with it at times to reduce the toxicity. Other than aminoglycosides, ceftazidime is preferred because of this toxicity of aminoglycosides. Hemorrhagic occlusive retinal vasculitis. It is a rare but devastating complication of endophthalmitis management and prophylaxis. HORV is delayed hypersensitivity to vancomycin. It is also seen when vancomycin was used as a prophylaxis with cataract surgery when it was given intracamerally. The management is early steroid treatment with subsequent anti-VEGF and PRP laser to prevent the NVG. Incidence of vitreous floaters was noted around less than 1%. Vitreous opacities are made up of inflammatory cells, transudates, necrotic tissue. Aggressive management with steroids can lead to gradual resolution of vitreous opacities. Vitrectomy, yes, is effective in removing non-clearing debris and to effect more rapid visual rehabilitation. Retinal detachment is a feared complication with a risk of 7.4 to 8.3%. Complicated cataract surgeries with broken capsules, vitreous phase disturbed, longer operative time, retained lens material are always at higher risk of intraocular infection. Not surprisingly, these cases are at high risk of detachment also. So the incidence in EVS was found to be 8.3%, but there was no difference found whether the patient was taken for vitrectomy or TAP biopsy. The factors which were increasing the risk of RRD were more virulent organisms, poor presenting visual acuity, an open posterior capsule at presentation, and patient who required an early additional procedure in the management of their endophthalmitis. Surgery for RRD status post endophthalmitis is difficult for the surgeon because of the corneal haze. At times we have small non-dilating pupil. Proliferative vitreoretinopathy is a major risk. These endophthalmitis cases at times have necrotic retina with atrophic retinal breaks, and we have optic neuropathy. The anatomical success is around 78% in EVS, but occurrence of detachment was correlated with poor visual outcome. Significant and protracted reduction of IOP after the treatment of endophthalmitis is an ominous sign, and we should look for choroidal detachment, retinal detachment, destruction of ciliary body function, ciliary body detachment from choroidal effusion or cyclitic membranes. Long-term hypotony devolves into thysis. So we should begin cycloplegia with the first-line medication. Topical steroids can be instituted as soon as it's deemed safe to mitigate the toxic effect of the infection and limit the acute and long-term sequelae of endophthalmitis. Timely VR intervention may salvage the vision and globe. Drainage of large choroidal detachments and small effusions may restore proper ciliary body apposition with normal return of IOP. Repair of RD with or without silicon oil excision of anterior vitreoretinal membranes, anterior loop tractions, cyclitic membranes can serve to elevate IOP to functional range. Visual prognosis after vitrectomy can be determined by the preoperative vision loss, infective severity, preoperative pathology for which the patient is being taken for vitrectomy, for vitreous opacities compared to RD. Visual results are highly variable. The patients who have initial poor vision with a culture positive for a virulent organisms, if they are taken for vitrectomy, they should be counseled for the potential of poor vision post-surgery also. But it can be considered in the setting of appropriate expectations and patient selection. Thank you.
Very good presentation, Dr. Garima.
I think Dr. Rajesh might be also answering this. You know, sometimes even after the vitrectomy for endop, after some time the patient has got good vision, and then after some time again the cells and the haze, vitreous haze starts. So was that because the core vitrectomy was not good enough, or something else should have been done?
See, core vitrectomy is only we cut the core of the vitreous. It's not the complete vitrectomy. So there's always a chance of such floaters later on as well. Or there could be a chronic endophthalmitis, which can lead to increase in the cells, flares, and symptoms.
So any scenario where you'd like to do a complete vitrectomy rather than a...
So we try to do as much as possible, depending upon the case.
Okay.
If it is a very, Abhijit can add few lines to it.
Basically, what happens after we give injection, in 95% cases, the vitreous cavity becomes sterile. But the toxins will be there, the bacterial toxins, particularly the gram-negative. Mm-hmm. And then if we do core vitrectomy, that toxin can create perpetual problems for a long time, mm-hmm. Number one. Number two, few times it happens, if you give the injections, maybe particularly you will see for the gram-negative we have seen, the posterior cortical vitreous things don't clear.
Okay.
The core vitreous gets cleared. And slightly vision improves, but over the time, if you do clear very carefully USG, you can see with the chronic reaction, the posterior cortical vitreous again getting infiltrated with the exudates. So these two things are there. If the posterior cortical vitreous is affected, you have to go inside and do the maximum things, means take out the vitreous, whatever left. But if it is due to the toxins and you see the mostly inflammation, then long-term steroids you may have to give. Antibiotic cover.
One more thing I would like to add here in Garima's presentation, that there is a high incidence of glaucoma. People don't check IOP post surgery, but there is a very high incidence of glaucoma in most of the post-op end of cases if it goes successfully. And many times you will see there will be iris neovascularization also. Despite a good vision, clearer cornea, even the AC reactions won't be there, but there will be iris vascularization. These are sometimes cause for raised IOP.
In some cases of this chronic uveitis cases, post-endop, you may have to take the IOL and the capsule also later on.
Mm-hmm.
Because the patient gets really irritated with so long redness and watering problem, vision decrease.
Okay, thanks very much, Dr. Garima. Our last but not the least, stalwart from Patna, and AIMS alumni, Dr. Nagen Prasad, will be talking about the preoperative care, OT protocols, and documentation in a case of endophthalmitis.
First, I would like to thank Dr. Rajesh for giving me the opportunity in this very prestigious IC. And I would like to thank the audience still here, the last IC of the session, of the conference. My topic is pre-op cares, OT protocols, and documentation. Need not to say that endophthalmitis is a direct complication and a condition, and it is the best way to do it is to prevent it. And it is a big challenge because there are so many factors involved, and there is no standard protocol. Different people doing different protocols for the curbing the this complication. And there is individual variation and custom for the management of this endophthalmitis. The best way to technique for infection profiling are aimed at reducing the organism on the ocular surface prior to the surgery. That way you can decrease the bacterial load going into the eye. Reducing exposure to the organism during the surgical procedure. Don't give chance to multiply there in the ocular tissue. And eradicating the bacteria that enter the eye after the cataract surgery by various prophylactic antibiotics. And first you need to identify those who are the high risk cases, already dealt by previous speakers. For the sake of identification of the high risk cases, the patient who are old, debilitated patient, and those who are immunocompromised, complicated cases and likely to be having vitreous loss or posterior portal cataract, these are the cases where you can have high risk cases, and if a complication leads to poor this type of endophthalmitis. And meticulous lid hygiene is utmost important. Cleaning of the lashes, lid, and ocular tissue. Prior treatment of meibomitis, STI, cyst, and dacryocystitis should be taken care of, because it has been seen this the when you do the vitreous culture from the in the case of endophthalmitis, the mostly the it is not the organism which causes the which is present in the conjunctival sac, rather the lid margins and the periocular tissue. So meticulous hygiene is very utmost important. If patient is suffering from hypertension, diabetes, and any other systemic disease, control of the disease is important. Like blood pressure should not be more than 165 to 90, rather 160/90. Fasting blood sugar less than 140 milligram per cent, and random or postprandial blood should not be more than 200 milligram. Medical fitness from the qualified physician is must, because it saves you if you go for the legal battle. And on the day of the surgery, there should not be any contact pressure like biometry, tonometry on the day of the surgery. Pre-operative topical antibiotic is not mandatory, but if you want to use, you can use a broad spectrum antibiotic, because there is a various studies which shows that using antibiotic 3 days before the surgery and on the day of the surgery, there is a difference. And if you give the on the topical antibiotic on the day of the surgery, give rise to more resistant than the previous 3 days. And so far as providone iodine is concerned, it should be the 5%, and it should be mandatory. Always put providone iodine into the conjunctival sac, periocular tissue, and all. And contact time should not be less than 3 minutes. Rather, you can increase your contact time depending upon the cases of when you, how much cases you are going to operate. And plastic drapes is must to cover the lid margin and lashes properly. Hygiene to the patient is also important. Ask the patient to take the full bath a day or day onto surgery, or washing the hair, face, feet, and soap with water thoroughly. Patient to wear clean washed cloth, OT dress with cap and gown. Patient should not wear the own cloth head or street cloth. Feet should be covered with the disposable back, disposable shoe cover. Apply providone iodine 5% on the skin and periorbital area and leave dry for 3 minutes before shifting to the OT table, and to be painted again on the table and give some time to dry it. Disposable adhesive drape is must to isolate lid, and tucking the lashes within the drapes is important. And you should not cut, you need not to cut the eyelashes, because cutting the eyelashes might increase the chances of infection. A speculum, if you want to choose, better to choose the screw one, and the wire speculum gives the poor exposure, or sometimes the eyelashes may poke through the drapes and may contaminate the surgical field. Installation of 5% providone iodine for 3 minutes is must, as I previously said. So far as the OT protocol is concerned, written informed should be mandatory. It should be in a patient language and explaining the risk and benefit of the patient, and what benefits going to expect, and is to be signed by patient, his or relative, or the interpreter if required. Consent paper should be, this is important, consent paper should be handed over to the patient 1 or 2 days before the surgery, so he can read fully and understand fully the what it is written in the consent paper. This is very important if something happens wrong to the patient. Anesthetic is ideal, but the basic life support and technician staff is sufficient in the OT to tackle with any untoward condition. Pulse oximeter machine is mandatory for all cases under topical or local anesthesia. High risk cases where patient having three or more comorbidity, anesthesiologists or physicians should be there in the OT. You must call them for monitoring the case, and IV lines should be maintained. Emergency drug is mandatory, as happens in each and every OT. You have to have these drugs in your kitty. And provision to transfer the patient to the hospital should be there in the case of a patient having some emergency. For the doctors and staff, again, anybody entering the OT must change their clothes in the changing room. Clothes should be washed and clean. Anyone with obvious infection should not be allowed to enter into the OT. Separate sleepers for OT and bathroom with color coding should be there. No street cloth is inside the OT for anyone. Hand scrubbing is done with betadine soap solution or chlorhexidine scrub for at least 3 minutes. If liquid soap is there, you wash for 5 minutes, but no bar soap should be allowed in those conditions. For scrubbing, purified water or RO aqua guard water should be used, and OT staff should not get close towards the OT trolley or towards the patient as to minimize the air exchange. Sterilize fresh new pair of gloves for every cases, and use sterilium in between the cases. This is a protocol, user protocol. Preferably, a sterile disposable gown with water resistant property should be used, or you can sterilize linen gown can be used, but sometimes linen gown may swell and give sterility may be compromised. So better one is a disposable and water resistant gown. Mask should cover nose and mouth too. OT cap to be worn properly, tucking in all hair. And a scrubbed hand with gloves should be in front, in the position in front of your waist, in front of your chest and above the waist to minimize inadvertent contamination. Surgeon, including all staff, should not come out OT with the dress on. If he came out for any reason, must change and re-scrub. OT microscope handle should be covered with a sterilized handle cover supplied along with the company. Don't use a towel. There is a very tricky situation in those cases. Towel should not be used on those, on the over the microscope. Sometimes we use towel if there is no. So far as intraocular fluids is concerned, one for one rule, one bottle of fluid for one patient, but this is not practically possible. Everybody using the single bottle of fluid for multiple, so you can use, but better to one for one bottle, patient for one bottle. Preferably pouch or plastic bottle should be used because it gives better sterility and there is a less chance of cracks like in bottle one. In case of using glass bottle, always do vacuum test. And that means you look for the bubble upon putting the IV set. If the bubble is going inside, then your bottle is sterile. Before use, inspect bottle against the light physically to look for the clarity and any growth. BSS or Runger lactate are equally effective, and no need to re-sterilize the sealed bottles. So far as the wound security is concerned on the table, always ensure the wound are not leaky. And when he drops, put a suture for the wound tightness. Keep the OT on IOP on the higher side at the end of the surgery, as Dr. Rajesh has already talked about it. If you are using large incision, it should not be too tight. But if you are doing phaco, it should be on higher side to prevent sucking back of the conjunctival fluid sac. Anything which goes inside the eye should be including instrument, phaco sleeve, phaco tip, cannula, vitrectomy cutter, change in any case. Intracanular antibiotic is preferable. No subconjunctival antibiotic or topical antibiotic usually doesn't do good. Strictly no to the betadine drops at the end of the surgery and try to finish the surgery within 15 minutes time. Beyond that, local disinfectant effect is waning. Post-operative measure, standard patching. If you are doing topical, so no need to patch, putting the glasses only. If you are using blocks, 4 to 6 hours of patching should be sufficient. Call for the patient to see next day, 3 to 7 days, and 25 to 30 days. Topical antibiotics should be given. Topical steroid, systemic antibiotic is not required.
but for the medical legal purpose you must view, because judges are not going to know that you have not started antibiotic or not. No touching of the eyes, no head bath for the 7 days, personal hygiene to be emphasized, visual acuity with pinhole to be recorded, document all finding and to be preserved, educate patient for emergency like pain, diminution of vision, floater center phobia, and return back immediately to the operating surgeon. Osteoslicing dedicated IOT should be used. It should be divided into 4 zones. Outer zone, where it is called protective zone, it should be reception, mid zone, clean zone, common area, changing, transfer to the patient to the OT. Aseptic zone, a sterile zone, where we can use scrubbing, gowning, gloving, OT, autoclave, room should be there, depending upon your space, and a disposable zone, where all the disposal can be kept. So far as fumigation is concerned, in the OT is new, 3 OT washing followed by fumigation and get 3 consecutive negative culture. Fumigation is not required if there is a positive pressure ventilation in the OT. Running OT, one single fumigation weekly, disinfective mopping, fogging weekly is enough. Use of fogger machine is preferably. Formalin or newer ingredients can be used, like Bacillus, special bacillate fumigation. These are the different materials used nowadays. Gives better sterility of the OT. Important consideration, air conditioner should be, no window AC should be allowed. Split AC is sufficient, central AC not necessary. Clean the filters every week. Servicing and cleaning every month and documented, it should be documented on the register. Floor microscope surfacing drain must be cleaned daily. Wall if tiled should be washed up to 4 feet. Mopping with 2% bacillate as special to the floor, no dry, dusting of vacuum. A space of the OT size, 160 square feet for 4 person, but the NABH protocol, 400 square feet as it is not practical, and you can reduce your proponent size depending and reduce your number of the people inside the OT. For the sterilization, autoclave or flash autoclave should be there. ETO is preferable, all the instruments should be ETO. In cases, between the cases, you use flash autoclaves. Class B autoclave for long tubing sterilization is required. No chemical sterilization like Cydex or formalin box and all. Monitoring the sterilization, the chemical indicator should be there. Should be 3 indicators, one outside the wrap, second inside the wrap, third inside the tray. And log book should be maintained. All the indicators should be kept on the register and date put on the date and to be maintained log book. Maximum use of disposable instruments are is preferably. Periodic culture should be taken every 3 to 4 months. So a few words about cluster infection. Already Dr. Indu has already enumerated. Just a few words. The cluster infection is defined as a occurrence of 2 or more than 2 infection in a single day from one theater, or the occurrence of repeated post-operative infection you are getting. In those cases, take the culture from the OT, note the batch number of all solutions and send sample for culture. Keep all solution used in safe custody in a sterile zone. Initiate treatment, refer to the higher center, inform the higher authority of the hospital. And stop surgery and review all protocols and take proper amendment. Inform AIFs and State Ophthalmic Society for the help. Engage and seek help of lawyer or legal cell of the AIFs. Already they are in these cases. So far as documentation is concerned, your surgery and the document should be in a way that it justifies the cataract surgery, taking into consideration the chief complaint, visual acuity, lifestyle complaint. The patient chief complaint conveys symptoms like blood vision, visual distortion, reduced contrast, sepsis, and complaint of glare associated with functional impairment should be there. It should be document should be like this, or your prescription should be like this. And this these patient symptoms are interfering with the daily day-to-day life is not. It should be documented also in your prescription or in the paper. Visual acuity record must be there, and so patient having difficulty with decreased vision. Cataract document should provide evidence that cataract is there in the patient having cataract. And if there is any reason for the surgery, like lens-induced glaucoma, retinal disease that requires a clear lens restriction, should be documented properly. And expected improvement or like prognosis, what should be the prognosis of the case, should be clearly conveyed to the patient. And the documentation should indicate that glass or other visual aid do not provide satisfactory functioning vision, then you have a proper justification for doing the cataract surgery. It should be documented. Investigation pertaining to the need and depending on the patient, you can order and physician clearance and signature should be there, the patient relative and surgeon also there. This is all, that's all I have to say, and thanks for your patience hearing. Any question, please, must be.
I have few questions, practical questions. First is, suppose fasting blood sugar is more, but the hemoglobin A1C is 6.
Sir, recently, actually what happens, you cannot consider, you cannot document for the HbA1c is you for the guideline for the endophthalmitis, how much HbA1c should be taken or not. It should be only fasting blood sugar which matters most. And physician clearance helps in those conditions.
See,
HbA1c
till date from the AIOS guidelines have not been specified for the ocular surgeries.
Yeah.
But other surgeries like knee transplantation and all, they take 10 as the upper limit. See, in our cases, usually we have those senile cases wherein usually they have diabetes. So suppose there is a case which has not been controlled for last 3-4 months, but for last week or so it is controlled, then we can very well take it. So according to the AIOS guidelines, as per the intraocular surgeries, HbA1c is not a criteria.
Yeah, it should not be made guideline because
it is not a guideline.
To have some paper on SOP, sir. If you are putting this,
less
this
than
as
200.
A guideline, then you are unsellable for that.
Less
so
than
you
200 you can very well take.
Yeah,
PP less than 200.
Fasting blood sugar is important and blood pressure is important.
Consent, cataract consent means
it should be positive, it should not be
yeah,
always
so
scary.
If we tell
and
like you sign, you can lose your eyes, you will get end off and we'll do so.
You
I
have to write it down, sir, and give
no,
it.
No, no, means how the practical way how we are going to present it, that I am telling. Like in retina surgery, we write all those.
If you are coming here, you have come by some way, you are not, you did not get into the accident, the accident might happen at any time.
Mm.
So basically, you can console or convince the patient like this.
So we have to write it positive way.
Positive way.
But informing
them, but
the dangers
yeah.
also.
And you should supply the consent from previous days.
Okay.
Sir, we have an audience for a question, yeah.
Yeah.
Your question.
Sir, we have the area where patients came on the day and they want the surgery on the same day. But you told that don't do the A scan on the same day.
That is
then
a practical problem.
Will you give in some extra hint or
extra precaution?
Only you can do only you use clean your ultrasound probe or your contact probe clearly properly, and then use antibiotics. Antibiotic is not recommended. I have gone through the recent literature. It is not recommended on the day of the surgery. If you have to use it, use for 3 days prior to the surgery.
To
clean the instrument, then you providen hygiene is almost as a guideline taking. Because we do intravitreals and all by putting the providen iodine for that. But the contact signs will be not less than 3 minutes. It should be more than 2 minutes. Or proper washing. These are unusual situations. There is no guideline for that. So it is not recommended at all. So you go for that kind of thing. But I do, most of the people are already doing it
yes.
like that. So no problem.
We do
so
that, but etiquette precautions are to be taken.
But if you have optical kind of thing, then it is good. Optical, you cannot, you don't require to touch the patient. Optical biometers are very good. You don't touch.
See,
but
I would
you
like
are taking. Yes.
Powdered iodine installation after surgery. Most of the surgeons recommended, but you should told that. Not put the powdered drops after surgery.
Yeah, it is not. It might go into the eye, no, may lead to devastating complication. It is not recommended. Not even the AIOS guideline. Actually, I was yesterday meeting with the AIOS people for the making the guideline for the SAARC country. So it is where we discuss. Some surgeons were asking for the putting a conjunctival betadine drops at the end of surgery. It should not be done. It goes. It might suck.
there is a chance of getting only, it may go into the eye, may lead to.
Sir, I have the laminar OT. Is it necessary to do fumigation or every surgery before?
Pardon?
Laminar OT. I have the laminar OT.
Yeah.
And fumigation is necessary?
No, in those cases you don't require to get for fumigation.
But those people who built the laminar OT, they told that they should have fumigation.
Usually we do, but it is not recommended at all.
That's no sir, that's usually.
Thank you.
And what about the dress in camp situation? Plenty of camps we do. So in those camps, how will you ensure the patient wears the proper dress or the takes a bath and they comes maybe in
what we can do minimum thing?
Multiples obtain. So what we will do? We will do. Practically I'm asking, not I'm
actually camp surgery you take as much as control of the some cases would be excluded, like one night patient, multiple surgery patient having.
See, I would like to add.
Yeah.
See, in more than 90% of the cases of endophthalmitis, the organisms that they have isolated are clinically indistinguishable from the organisms that are normally inhabiting the conjunctival sac. So it is very important to ensure complete sterility and asepsis during any intraocular procedure and to defer surgeries in all those cases when you have some local infective pathologies like dendrocystitis, MGDs, blepharitis and all. You should never operate in presence of those conditions.
That's all right.
And we are all blessed with very important defense mechanism in almost one third of the cases after intraocular surgeries, you can isolate the organism from the anterior chamber. But because the virulence of the organism is less and the host defenses are very strong, like every 100 hours, you have the recycle of the aqueous. They are the main protective mechanisms which ensure
sterility.
When the virulent bacteria go inside, may not get the multiplication because they've got pass of that.
Because every 100 minutes it is changed.
I have one statement for Abhijit's question that what one should do in camps. The eyes of patients getting operated in camps are equally precious.
Yeah.
No, what happened?
No, there's a guideline.
In Arvind, in ours also we do hundreds of surgeries. In Monday there will be 100 or 90 surgeries. So they come in their dresses only and we put the head cap and the leg coverings only, and we clean them up not for the bath or the other things, we just clean the eye and the face only.
Local periocular hygiene is of utmost importance.
Periocular hygiene or surgeon, 4 hours should not do more than 40 or 50 cases per OT. 40 to 50 cases should not more than that. So
if it goes like suppose 3 OTs, we do 300 surgeries. With the 5 surgeons maybe, so that happens.
That is.
So those cases, our infection rates are very negligible, Rajesh also knows that. So I think the practical approach is immediately managing the patient and the hygiene of the face and the eye which we take before the OT.
But the point here is, practically there are so many things which are acceptable to all of us, but if you go to the court of law, there are many things which are not acceptable because there are NABH accreditation guidelines. Where you need to follow them,
it
adhere to
not
them.
The guideline. If you put in the guideline, then you are answerable.
Yes,
you
are answerable.
That's why you did
we
that.
We are NABH accredited. And
still, you are violating.
No. We are not violating because we are very strict about our record keeping. So they don't have any guidelines about how long before you will make the patient bath or other things. That I am telling very clearly. There is no guideline about bath.
It is your choice.
Yeah.
Yeah, very good. Thank you, audience. It was actually very morale booster for us that we could see someone sitting there, in the audience as well. Thank you very much for your patient hearing.